Northlanders. Saturday, the Duluth News Tribune released its 23rd episode of the Northlandia Podcast, a weekly podcast that tells true stories of the unique and fascinating people and places you'll find exploring the Northland. In the latest episode, reporter Terry Caddo looks into the origins and tales of some of the Northland's unique statues.
As you're going into two harbors, you'll see on your left side of the road a 8-foot-tall rooster in front of a gift shop called Weldon's. And I called up... This is the first one that I reached out to anyone to cover, and I called a woman intending to leave a message, and she answered her phone at 8 o'clock at night, which I appreciated, but also I felt a little bit bad. And she told me, "Oh yeah, that's been with us since 1965, and her parents had to open up that store. Her father is the Weldon of Weldon's Gifts in 1963, and it's been there ever since, except for the 3 times that it got stolen by other people."
To give you another opportunity to see what stories Northlandia has to offer, we're providing the 8th episode here for you to listen. This episode was first released on April 22nd. If you enjoyed the episode, we encourage you to check out all the other episodes of Northlandia at DuluthNewsTribune.com or wherever you get your podcasts. Enjoy.
Welcome to Northlandia. A place to bring your curiosity, because here you'll find curiosities. I'm Wyatt Buckner, the Duluth News Tribune, and I will be your guide as we discover the unique and fascinating stories here in the Northland. Here we celebrate the region's distinctive people, places, and history. In this episode, we introduce you to a pinball duo who are fixing machines and building a community here in the Twin Ports. Let's venture forth into Northlandia. After inserting your quarter and launching the ball, it's hard not to recognize the sounds that follow when you play a game of pinball. Though for many, like myself, it's been years since playing the classic game. So here to tell us more about this duo who's trying to make pinball an active part of the community, I'm joined again by News Tribune reporter Jimmy Lovren. Jimmy, welcome back to the Northlandia Podcast.
Thanks, Wyatt. Good to be here.
Yeah, so first off, let's start off with how did you find the story and what interested you about it?
Yeah, I think I was just looking on Facebook one day and a recommended group was Twin Ports Pinball. And I was intrigued. I went onto it. It was public. And so I was kind of looking through and it had, you know, 80, 90 members or so. And they were regularly meeting up. You know, people would let each other know when a machine was broken in Duluth or Superior. And then there was one account, Parnell Pinball, who was clearly kind of leading it all and rallying people together for Thursday night events and tournaments and everything. And so I messaged him. And from there, we met up last week at Average Joe's in Superior, where they've got 5 pinball machines, and chatted with them.
So obviously we're talking about a community, an apparent community of pinball enthusiasts in the Twin Ports, but let's start with Parnell, and what started him down this path of the way of the pinball?
Yeah, so Parnell Lutz said he kind of got his start into pinball just playing online with some friends, you know, from a computer. And then he started to get into the physical machines themselves and found he really liked tinkering with them. So the Rex in Duluth in the Fitgers building is owned by Mike Lemon, and they had a pinball machine or two. And so Parnell would go over there, play, got to know the owner, Mike, and then offered, "Hey, can I fix these machines?" And you know, from there, they've gone and they still have 2 machines there at the Rex. But Mike Lemon went on to buy Average Joe's in Superior, and he now has 5 machines there. Parnell owns a few. He owns a few. Parnell owns it with his friend and apprentice, if you will, Bob Fur. And so they kind of go between 2 of Mike's bars on every Thursday night with a group of friends that they organize through Facebook and just play pinball. Usually about once a month, they do a tournament and kind of get competitive there. But yeah, every Thursday night they're meeting and they're playing pinball, and it's kind of unique because there aren't many places. Well, they say that there aren't any up here that they're aware of that have more than 1 machine, except for the Rex and Average Joe's. You have to go as far as Ashland, where the Stagecoach Bar, they've got several machines, and they've kind of got their own community over there in Ashland that the Twin Ports pinball community kind of sometimes meets up with, and there's some crossover there. But yeah, there's a community that bands around these machines, and Parnell and Bob, they love tinkering with them. They love fixing them. They break down a lot, and so then they take it upon themselves to care for them, make sure they're up and running, and then they've got kind of their own, they're hoping to launch kind of their own business of fixing them as well.
I've always been very like technical and do-it-yourself, tinkering a lot with stuff, and for some reason, I didn't get into pinball until I was 28, and then and it was a real hard dive into that hobby. I'm not really good at playing, but I love fixing them, and that's kind of like that side hobby of just tearing everything apart, figuring out how it works, fixing it, putting it back together.
So now that we've talked about Parnell, and we touched on this a little bit, but let's talk a little more about the other half of the duo, Bob. So tell me more about Bob.
Yeah, so Bob said he started to get into pinball 4 or 5 years ago, became friends with Parnell, and then for the last year or so, he said he's kind of Parnell's apprentice. The two want to create a business where they fix these machines. They already tinker with these themselves, you know, word of mouth, they fix these for people, but now they're going to do it a little bit more formally, they say. And Bob and Parnell also have a podcast together about pinball, Flippin' and Mashin', which they're hoping to kind of do monthly. It's been a few months since they've had an episode, but they're going to revive it and do that. So together, they're doing those types of things, but they're also organizing those Thursday evening meetups, usually at Average Joe's, sometimes at the Rex, and then monthly tournaments as well. So yeah, they are kind of the main people here organizing and getting people to band together and play pinball.
When I was a kid, I played it, and I haven't played it since probably about 4 or 5 years ago when I met Parnell. And then after that, we kind of hung out every once in a while. And then he's like, hey, you want to be a little bit more interested? I want an apprentice that I can teach how to fix them. So this within this last year, dove in deep with him, fix up a bunch of machines, and same kind of thing, just love tinkering around with stuff, figuring out what's broken, just diving in to try to fix out and find out what's going on with them.
So beyond Parnell and Bob, talk to me a little bit more about the community that they're kind of forming.
Yeah, so they said that really it's just the Rex and Average Joe's in the Twin Ports that have more than one machine. There's a few machines here and there, but they're often broken down. And so when you get more than one machine together, people start gathering. And so beyond their formal Thursday evening meetups and then tournaments, they also do kind of this scoreboard, running scoreboard that's on a display above the machines. And you can kind of get together and see, you know, you might go play by yourself, but then you're ranking yourself against someone, and they kind of described, you know, random usernames showing up that they weren't familiar with, and then they try to figure out who it was and invite them to the, you know, the Thursday night pinball nights and stuff. But yeah, it sounds like people, you know, from outside the Twin Ports join them, again, down from the cities or elsewhere, and you know, they're trying to get 20 people to a tournament sometimes. I think they said they got to 16. So it's a small but enthusiastic community of people who are into it. And beyond, you know, I guess in our region, they said really the only other kind of community like that is over in Ashland, where the Stagecoach Bar has more than, you know, they've got several machines there. So a community of pinball players have kind of popped up over in Ashland, and there's some, you know, crossover between the two, and they try to do some things together, invite each other to different things. So yeah, it's a really small niche group of enthusiasts, but they're trying to kind of foster it and bring people together and just, you know, socialize and bond over pinball.
Yeah, and beyond the game itself, it seems like a lot of that bonding in the community seems to come from a fun, competitive spirit. And whether it's remotely where they're seeing the scores appear on the machines and they're wondering who did it and they want to beat that score, but even with these tournaments and how they bring potentially over a dozen plus people together to play competitively directly against each other.
We do a very basic setup of everybody gets three games. So you're guaranteed three games, and then there's finals of the top four players. And so we use a software called Match Play, and it kind of calculates where you placed. And if you placed first or second more often than the other person, you win that tie. So you get the top four players, and then they battle it out for one final game. And then that rank is the top three get payout, and the fourth person gets fourth.
Usually consists between 10 to 16 people. Hopefully more. We'll get some more coming in.
So while we were talking with them at Average Joe's, we did a few things. One, we did a traditional interview with them, and then for video and stills, we watched them play some pinball. And then later, you and I played a little bit of pinball ourselves. So I want to talk about both of those, because I feel like there's an interesting comparison there. So before we talk about them playing, let's talk about us playing. Because speaking of myself, that was my first time playing pinball in many, many years. I don't even remember the last time. Definitely not since I was an adult. I don't know about you.
It's been a while. I don't think I've played probably since, you know, the bowling alley arcade growing up. And I don't know how long ago that was. So yeah, I really had no idea what I was doing. There's a lot going on. It's beyond just trying to prevent the ball from going down the hole and keeping it in play. There's things to aim for. There's, you know, challenges within the game where you can score more points. There's a screen above the machine that kind of has their own challenges and storyline to go with it. But yeah, we played the Foo Fighters edition of the machine there. And yeah, you creamed me. I think you had like double the score. And I don't really know how the scoring works, but you came out way on top.
No, I have no idea. I did take a photo of it because I did think it was interesting, because you had 4,032,440 points, and I somehow, again, just like you, I have no idea what was going on, and then I was just hitting the balls and having fun. 8,281,050 points. And for us who don't play this, to me, it's hard not to feel like it's just a bunch of luck. Like, I'm just hitting the ball when it comes down, blah, blah, blah. Fun lights are happening, and for someone who hasn't played for a long time, I feel like that's just kind of to be expected, that's the experience. But versus, like, say you move on from the two of us who are completely amateurs, comparing to Parnell and Bob, who they themselves don't say they're experts at playing. They have both said that they are better at repairing them than playing them, but they look like they at least have a goal and objective. They understand what's going on the field, and they talk a lot about the strategy involved in pinball, because apparently there is strategy in pinball.
Right. Yeah, no, and I think that the difference is that they even kind of get in a stance above the machine, whereas I just kind of, you know, put my hands on the buttons and kind of went for it, but they each kind of had an athletic stance, almost standing at the machine and very focused. They knew what they were doing. Didn't talk a whole lot when they played because they were focused, and their rounds were much longer than the, you know, few seconds it felt like some of ours were. But yeah, they, you know, there are ways to catch the ball and kind of stop it on those paddles down there, and then launch it and get the right angle, and so there's a skill to it. It's not just by chance, and they've, you know, they can do that all day long.
Yeah, and Pardell had some good tips for how to play a little more intentionally than just randomly hitting the ball.
To be really good and have a good game, you have to slow down. And you're not just flipping. You have to stop the ball. It's called trapping it up. And you aim your shot. So you aim to what you want, and then the ball comes back, and you have to stop the slingshots from firing the ball to create chaos. You don't want chaos. So you want control of the ball. It takes tons of practice. You will not get good right away.
So yeah, as they've talked about and kind of demonstrated to a certain extent, that it's definitely a lot of skill involved. It's not just luck, as you know, especially for a newbie, it feels like it's just luck you're hitting the ball. And there's definitely times where the ball just kind of goes straight down the hole out of nowhere. But as Bob, I think the exact quote from Bob was, all skill, never say it's luck. But there's also like a weird dichotomy too, because I know there was one time when I was filming Bob play, and it's straight up, he fired the ball, it made like one little loop above and just went straight down the middle, straight through the tube. And he did jokingly respond like, "That's just bad luck." But at the same time, he has to reconcile, no, it's not luck. There's skill involved. It's just as weird. It's interesting because there definitely is skill involved, but right, there's certainly an element of luck being on your favor or not.
There are times where the ball goes where it wants to go, and you can't do anything about it. But for the most part, you can kind of, if you're able to control that ball, there's a lot more skill involved. But yes, there are the times where that ball is going to go where it wants to go, and you're not going to be able to do anything about it.
I think we've kind of touched on this, but just kind of to make it more clear, what is the skill level of everyone participating within this group? Is it more like exclusively serious pinball players who are just like high-level competitors, or is there a more mix of fresh off the street, never played pinball or hasn't played in so many years?
Yeah, Bob and Parnell said beginners welcome. They just want people to, you know, be exposed to pinball and enjoy pinball. So yeah, there are some good players, it sounds like, that sometimes come up from the cities, you know, and they each consider themselves to be average players. Like you said, they like to tinker with and fix the machines. That's where their skill pinball is, but they are still, you know, they consider themselves average players, probably, you know, compared to us, they're really good. But no, I think it sounds like a range of skill levels show up Thursday, and it doesn't really matter. Again, it's just to kind of build community, you know, play some pinball, have some drinks, and yeah, I don't think people should be worried if they're interested in pinball, but don't think they're very good. I mean, these are, you know, monsters and Godzilla-themed machines after all.
Yeah, and even Parnell and Bob, when I asked them directly, like, how would you rank themselves? And this was their response.
Poor.
If you saw my IFPA number, it's not very high.
Right. You are better than I am for now. But I would say I'm still very much of a beginner in it. My name's usually either not on the top 10 board, or it's number 10 or 8, so 8 or 9 or 10. Very much a beginner still.
I might be average or like a tad above. It really, yeah, it's the whole thing of like when I slow down, I can actually have good games. But it's not fun to stop playing, you know, like, and hold the ball. I just want to keep flipping.
with that ball to be going everywhere. But yeah, that's not conducive to having a good game all the time.
So we've mentioned a couple of them earlier, but let's talk about the different themed games they have that Average Joe's. I think they said that there was five games there. Yeah, let's talk about what all the different themes were there.
Yeah, so it's kind of like bands, musicians, TV shows, movies is kind of where these themes tend to go, I think. There at Average Joe's, there was a Munsters themed, a Foo Fighters themed, a Rush themed, Godzilla themed, and The Mandalorian. Mm-hmm. And
we dare not have them play the Mandalorian one only because it's owned by Disney and don't want to have any risk of any Star Wars sound of any kind
exactly.
making its way because Disney will not show mercy.
Right. And so, yeah, the all of these themes, you know, beyond just the background and kind of the playing field or, you know, under the glass, they've kind of got themed images and obstacles, I guess I would call them. But then there's a screen on each of them that kind of also, you know, have a storyline that kind of goes. There's different like challenges within the game that play on the screen. You know, for some of those band ones, you can select a song that is playing while you play. So yeah, it's kind of, they kind of create their own little world there. And then that's kind of what draws Parnell into it, is just being immersed in that.
They call it the world under glass. So this world. And so like when you play Tron based off the newer Legacy movie or Lord of the Rings, like you get the audio and the call outs of like a character from that movie or story. And it, if you enjoy that stuff, it like feels really good. It feels like you're in it and you're playing the movie or whatever it is. And so there's like that aspect of just getting pulled into the story.
Yeah, I definitely think it's accurate or fair to say that the themes can easily draw you in. Even, again, as mentioned before, I hadn't played pinball in quite a long time. Just seeing the machines right away and seeing, oh, the Mandalorian, seeing that connection with Star Wars, that I just instantly was drawn to it and wanted to play it. Stop myself because I have aforementioned reasons, but that there's definitely that connection there. But even just like the other games as well, is having the lights flashing, and it's just so, there's so much that's like familiar with pinball that kind of like takes you back to, even though again it's been years since I've played it, watching it play and actually like hitting the buttons, just watching them play it and seeing all the lights and the sounds and everything just really just takes you all back to it. And it sounds like for Bob, that's kind of what really draws him in and keeps him going.
The lights, the sounds, the just a little bit of everything, the competition, the frustration, it holds on to you and it keeps coming back for more. It's like that ball goes on that drain and you're just like, I know I could do better next time. So you pop more coins in and you keep playing it. And then now it's people, like just hanging out with Parnell or the group that we're playing with and meeting new people and that kind of thing.
So Jimmy, I guess talk to me about, why do you think this group of pinball enthusiasts has a place here in Northlandia? Why do you think it fits so well here?
Yeah, I don't think people realize, you know, that pinball maybe still exists. You know, arcades are, you know, not really as big as they used to be, but pinball exists. And beyond that, there's a strong, loyal group of people who are into it. And we found some characters who are super into it and go beyond just playing it, but also fixing it. The machines, you know, they're buying machines to go put into bars. They're encouraging the bar owner, their friend, you know, to buy them as well. And so they've kind of all the aspects of pinball they're into, and beyond that, they share it with others. So it just seemed like, you know, such a distinct thing that many people don't think about, that and that's kind of what Northlandia tries to do, is what are those stories in our area where, you know, it's not something you normally think of, but it's happening and people are really into it. So it's unique, and I think readers will be interested and to learn, you know, what makes pinball enthusiasts tick.
Well, Jimmy, I think we'll wrap it up there. Thank you so much for joining us again. I'm hoping wherever you take us next is as fun as playing pinball, or at least as interesting.
Yeah, we'll see. I don't have a story yet, but I'll try.
And thank you for joining us on this venture into Northlandia. To read the article for this week's column, as well as see photos by Jed Carlson and video produced by myself, visit duluthnewstribune.com/topics/Northlandia. You can find all the episodes of Northlandia on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. If you or someone you know has a unique story that you believe could have a place here in Northlandia, let us know by emailing northlandia@duluthnews.com. Join us again next week and discover the extraordinary stories that you just might miss if you're not in the right place at the right time, ready to step off the beaten path with no rush to return, here in Northlandia.